talk about today is the cobot applications. Now, some of what we're going to discuss obviously applies to regular industrial robotics as well, but when we talk about cobots, I'm specifically going to talk about things that they do well, and then there's things that they don't do well. They don't fit all applications. A common misconception that people have is that, oh, this is a cobot application, or this is an industrial robot application. And that's only partly true. In all reality, they both do the same job. What differentiates them is going to be speed, payload, and your safety characteristics. So it's how you implement them that really determines whether or not you need a cobot or an industrial robot. You know, when it first came out, the cobots were marketed as being, well, they're so easy to use, you don't need an integrator. And they're so safe, you don't have to have any fencing. Well, people started installing them and realizing that that's not the case. In many cases, you will still possibly need an integrator depending upon how much engineering you want to do in like tooling and fixturing and things like that. They are very easy to use, but there is still going to be some level of programming. And regardless of what robot you're using, there's always going to be tooling and fixturing. So if you are capable and you want to do all that yourself, then by all means, a cobot is a great solution to get started into robotics. Some people want completely hands-off because they just don't have the engineering resources. Okay, well then we can get integrators involved to give you a full turnkey type solution. And regarding safety, yeah, it's true. You could have the robot just sitting there on a pedestal or on that table like I have out there. And inherently, cobots are smooth-bodied. They don't have pinch points. And if you're carrying a vacuum gripper, it's not inherently dangerous. However, 90% of the cobots that I've either sold or seen installed had some form of fencing around them. And that wasn't because it was dangerous, it's because you want to keep people out of the process. The whole point, generally, is when you're buying robotics, is you're looking for productivity. Well, the last thing you want to have is a bunch of people walking in and stopping the robot. That doesn't make any sense. So a lot of the cases, the fencing is not used to protect people, it's used to keep them away from the robot. So, but we do talk a little bit about safety in some of these applications as well. So feel free, like I said, to ask me any questions that you want. I'm going to cover three specific topics: palletizing, machine tending, and welding. And some of the things that they're very, very good at, and some of them they're kind of sketchy, whether you can use them or not. And also along these same lines is that there's products out there that make your engineering time very, very minimal. Machine bases are pre-engineered, the lift stations for the palleting, the grippers and things like that, already pre-engineered solutions. So we're developing function packages, so if you say, okay, here's what I'm doing, okay, here's the hardware to do it. So really what these three markets are, these three, palletizing, machine tending, and welding, are really three of the fastest growing areas of the cobot market because they're very popular, people use them all the time. And the cobots make it very, very easy. So we'll start with palletizing first. So there's still quite a bit of manual palletizing out there. I don't think anybody that's doing it actually enjoys doing it. Manual palletizing is not very fun. Even if you don't have, you know, heavy boxes, it's still a lot of lifting it up and down and stacking and things like that. So labor, obviously, I think we've all in agreement that labor is very difficult at this point, trying to get people to do something. Difficult. Keeping people on the job is difficult enough. Making them stack boxes as part of their job is just not going to, you know, not a lot of people want to do that. So if you can take that person and move them to a different operation and let the cobot do the palletizing, now you're making your employee happy, but you're also still getting your palletizing project done. And there is some cost savings, again, like you do more with the same amount of people. I mean, at this point in time, most people are not trying to eliminate employees, but you're trying to do more with what you have. So you can save some money there because a cobot palletizer, when applied into the right solution, is going to save you a lot of money over the larger, dedicated, big industrial palletizers. But it really comes down to what your project actually is. Because there are some things that the cobot one is just not going to do. And basically, when we get down to that, when you try to consider what you need to do when you go into a palletizing. So, do application handle a whole bunch of different items, and you've got 30 different boxes and all these different palette patterns, and you've got a spreadsheet of all the different things that you do, you've got all these different flow rates, that's probably realistically out of the realm of a Cobot palletizer. That's not to say it can't be done, but the complexity in the palletizing for doing those larger systems, the complexity lies in getting the right data into the robot to do the motion. Making the robot go over, pick up a box, and put it on a pallet is very simple. Making sure you're doing it the exact same way you want. If I've got 30 different boxes and 30 different pick points and all these different pallet patterns, how do you get that information into the cobot? And larger pallet cells, you typically have an HMI with a custom development put in an integrator. You got a PLC doing all the control, and the robot just does the motion. So that's a little bit different scenario than if you're using a cobot. The cobots are generally going to be lower speed, lower payload, and pretty much not the same box all the time, but you're going to be flexible enough to add new boxes, but you're not doing those huge systems. So some of it is the facilities layouts. A cobot tends to have a smaller footprint. So if I've got a small conveyor coming down and I want one conveyor and I want to fill my pallet, that's a fairly easy thing to do. I can put the cobot right here. Conveyor comes down and I build my pallet. Somebody forklifts it away and they bring in an empty pallet. Small footprint, right? You start looking at the industrial palletizers and you're probably looking at 12 feet back over here with fencing and everything like that. And it also depends, do I have one conveyor in, do I got two coming in, am I building two pallet stacks, or am I doing a really large system where I might be doing four pallet stacks? So the size of your facility and the throughput is really going to also make a big determination whether or not you need an industrial palletizer or a cobot. Obviously the larger ones, that's a big dedicated cell that could be all the way from those tables all the way over to here. But the cobot ones are really nice because if I have one conveyor in, one pallet out, it's pretty simple. Even one conveyor in with two pallets out, it still doesn't take up a lot of floor space. And from a safety standpoint, you really don't need fencing around those cobot palletizers. What you might find, though, is that if I'm building a pallet here and a pallet there and I got the robot in the middle, you might have, fencing on this side and then fencing on that side just to keep people out of the process from coming in on the sides. You're going to have forklift traffic, obviously, bringing empty pallets in and full pallets out, so you have to account from a safety standpoint. Out here, everything on this side is now your warehouse. You've got forklift traffic on that side, and that you got to be concerned about all the time. But in this area here, when you bring the pallets in, you'll have pallet locators to tell the system that, yes, there's pallets there. But you might also end up with safety light curtains over here just to let, maybe stop the robot if for some reason somebody wanted to step onto the pallet, right? I don't know why they would, but stranger things have happened. So even though you don't necessarily need fencing and all that, you probably still put something out there to let somebody know that somebody's in the cell. Because the cobot itself isn't necessarily going to hurt you, and the gripper's probably just vacuum or something like that, so it's not inherently dangerous. But you probably still put some safety curtains out there. So, like I was saying earlier, most applications, even though it's a cobot, you still have to look at safety. So, and the training of the staff. You don't necessarily have to have your operators know programming, but there will be times when a box comes down the line and it's damaged so I can't pick it up. Okay, I didn't pull a vacuum on it, or maybe my vacuum cups are worn out, or for whatever reason I can't pick, or maybe as I was moving, something dropped something. So they have to gain access into that cell, clear any faults, any jams, anything like that. So they will need some basic training on how to start and stop and reset the system. The bigger cells that people build, you can do all that from outside the cell if somebody develops their HMI properly. With a cobot, because it's safe, usually walk into the cell and just manually move things around and then come back out and resume your operation. But you still have to have some level of training for your staff. So what do we look at? So for the application, there's some certain things that are key. Some of the limitations that we have, we'll discuss a little bit about that. And what actually do we do? What physically are you getting when you look at a palletizer? So how many different boxes? Again, if you're probably doing 6, 8, 10 different boxes, you could have different routines set up for each different product that you have. You get into really complicated, like, you know, 100 SKUs, then that might be a little bit of a challenge. Not to say it can't be done, but something to consider. So a typical do-it-yourself palletizer, you know, we start looking at, let's say, a lift table, some pallet locators, and a robot yourself, you're probably somewhere in the area of that. Maybe $80,000 to $85,000 range. Then, depending upon how crazy you get with your gripper, but you're typically from a hardware installation or a hardware card cost, you're under $100,000. So, looking at your budget, you know, the Cobot might be a good fit because if you want to do it yourself, you got a relatively straightforward application, doesn't have a lot of complexity. You can be in and out the door relatively quickly. You start getting into the full-on dedicated palletizing cells. Now you're talking 250, 300, 400 type. So looking at your budget constraints, that's kind of like your application is going to pretty much direct you down the road that you need to take. It'd be great to say that kind of like that $100,000 price point, but then all of a sudden somebody says I got to do, you know, one pick every 5 seconds or something like that, or one pick every 3 seconds. You're not going to do that with any cobot on the planet. So knowing your budget is great. But also the application is going to determine which direction you take. And like I said, from a layout standpoint, most of the Cobot based systems for mounting the lift and everything like that are designed for either one or two. You can still possibly use two conveyors in, but in the palletizing world, we typically call them like, you know, one in, one out, one in, two out, two in, four out, things like that. So those are the number of inline feeders and how many pallet stations are you building. If you get anything bigger than one in, two out, you're probably not using a cobot just because they don't have the reach. So what do we have from a hardware standpoint? Well, there's a lot of different solutions, but the box size, its weight, and its type is going to be a huge factor in how you can pick things. Surface, it may seem very simple to take a vacuum gripper, go over to a box, and pick it up. But cardboard is porous. Now, depending upon the type of cardboard, some is far more porous than others. So you have to look at probably 80% of the time, we'd want to test the vacuum solution on your actual product. And we can do that in a variety of different ways. We can send product to smalls. We have grippers ourselves, we can test. This happens to be on robot, so that's an electric vacuum gripper where it's got a pump already built in, so you don't have to run any airline, which also makes it very nice from a cobot standpoint. The thing about it, though, is because the cardboard is porous, you know, you want to do some testing, but also, what does the top of the product look like? If I've got a box of just folded flaps like this with a piece of tape down the side, well, that sounds easy, but it might start to tent like this if you pick it up from the top. And if it starts to tent like this, these cups will pull away. So you end up with half your cups and you end up dropping product. Some boxes are, you know, this fold comes over and then this one comes over and it's glued. That sounds great too, but now you got two different surfaces, right? So cups are an option, and almost always you'll see on the cups there'll be more bellows, which helps us when, you know, it's not a flat, perfect surface. But we also have foam grippers as well. And foam grippers work really well on those boxes, like I said, that have been folded because the foam will adjust for the different heights of the cardboard. But in almost all cases, you're going to want to test the product. The clamp style that you see up there, that's good if you want to, if you got a little bit heavier, clamp from the sides, and on the side of the fingers, there's like a foam type, you know, inlay that makes it so it's less slippery against cardboard. But one thing to consider with a clamp sound gripper is that as it weighs, you have to have more pressure in this direction. Also, is that pressure going to do anything to your box? Right? You want to crush obviously what's in your box. So the claw style, the clamp style, is very popular if you have to come at it from the side. But the other consideration when you're doing the clamp style is now when I place it, only one end of that is servo driven and moves. So when I place it, I got to make sure that if I've got a row of boxes here, and this is empty on this side, I put it down this way so this side can open up and then I can come back up. Likewise, we also have the option of saying, you know, do I want all the labels facing out? Some companies all want that so that when they put their pallet in, let's say, like a Sam's Club, all the labels are on the outside so the people walking up and down the aisle can see it. So we have solutions set for that as well. But when you're doing something like that, some planning has to be understood that when I'm placing that box, if I gripped it like this, can I place it like that? So when you're looking at the application, you really got to start thinking about the different steps of the process and what you're trying to do. And the other thing about the two jaw is that you're never going to get the boxes tight together. There's always going to be spaces between the boxes. So if you want to maximize the number of boxes and you want no gaps in between, then you're going to have to come with a solution that picks up vertically from the top. And that's pretty much the only thing you can do there is vacuum. So vacuum is primarily what most people use for palletizing, but the clamp style is certainly the next one that people use the most. What you see on that one also on the side, the little comes off like this before vacuum comes. And that's because the regular vacuum gripper can go over and pick up a slip sheet and set it on top. Put a slip sheet in between every layer. That one there being the clamp style, they put the vacuum on the side, so when it goes over to get the slip sheet, it just rotates like this, comes down, gets a slip sheet, and puts it onto the pallet. So the cases per minute or picks per minute, typically you're at six picks a minute or less. So you think 10 seconds, that sounds like a long time, but there's a lot that has to happen there. Picking from the conveyor, you might have a side rail on a conveyor, you gotta come up, you gotta come down to start your layer. Your overall pallet stack could be like 72 inches or something like that. So, I mean, as you start building, 10 seconds sounds like a long time, but you gotta remember you're not really going very fast, you're not throwing things around. So, you can probably maybe do 8 a minute. Typically people target that 6. Can you do 8 or 10? It's possible if your product is very good and the vacuum picks it up really easily. The other thing about vacuum is that maybe it takes 1 second for the vacuum to generate enough to clear all the vacuum out of the solution and pull that box tight, right? So you got to add in the gripper time into your solution. Just because the robot gets over here and comes down, it still might take a full second for it to generate enough vacuum so you can go again. Think about that 6 per minute range, you're probably pretty safe. If you want to get faster than that, then we just have a discussion about what your product is and what you're trying to do. If you really want to get fast, or let's say I want to do 35 boxes a minute, well, there might be times where I pick up 3 at a time, right? You can do that with some of these cobot palletizers depending upon how your gripper is arranged, but typically if you're doing multiple boxes in one pick, those are usually the industrial robots as well, because your gripper becomes heavier and you can do that. So, how is the infeed, right? How do the boxes come down? Is it a gravity-fed conveyor? Is it a powered conveyor? Again, a lot of the smaller manufacturers might have, somebody is over here, puts a bunch of stuff in a box and sends it down a conveyor. It's just gravity-fed. After they build up 10 of them, they walk over, they palletize them. So a gravity-fed conveyor is pretty common. Are you picking one box or multiple? And picking multiple is not really a challenge. Like with our smallest gripper, we just put individual zones, and we just turn on whichever zone we want. So if we want to pick up all 3, we turn on all the vacuum. If we only want to pick up these 2, we just turn on these 2 zones. Another important process process point to think about is, if for whatever reason the palletizer stops, like somebody walked into the cell, there's no pallet there, and the guy took off for lunch, and now they took a pallet away and never put a new pallet down, what happens to the upstream process? If somebody's still building boxes up there, what's going to happen to them? You know, do they get down a conveyor? Do you eventually have a sensor over here? And, you know, you've got 15 boxes on your conveyor. Do you put a sensor over here that if that's made, you tell that guy to stop sending me product? I mean, these are all things that you have to discuss when you're doing that process, because if this one stops, what happens to that one? And then more importantly, why did this one stop? Normally, a palletizer stops because either a sensor doesn't get made, like the vacuum sensor or product sensor, did I actually pick up the box I thought I was picking up, or there's no forklift there, things like that. So sensor failures or operator didn't do what they're supposed to do, that's typically what's going to stop a palletizing cell. You just got to be aware of it, that I can only drop boxes if there's a pallet there. So if somebody didn't put a pallet there, everything's going to shut down. It happens more than you would think, too. And on the outfeed, again, the same rules apply. I got a full pallet. Now, if I have a pallet station that's only one in, one out, if I still have boxes coming down, and this guy doesn't take that pallet away, there's nothing I can do. I can't go until somebody takes that pallet away, and more importantly, brings another pallet in. So the outfeed is very important. Common thing to do, at least in the higher volume, is to have a powered outfeed conveyor of a suitable length that I build my pallet right on that conveyor, and then I take that conveyor away, and let's say I've got 15 feet to work with, maybe I can get three full pallets there while I'm building a fourth. That gives them time to get some out of the way. So powered conveyors are very common. Something to be considered. And then how do the empty pallets come in? For larger industrial palletizers, they're big enough that you could have a stack of pallets, and they'll just go grab the top and off the stack of pallet, put it into a location, and then start building their pallet layers. No cobot is going to be able to do that. One, they can't carry the weight. Two, they don't have the reach. So if you need an automated feeder to bring the pallets in, that's going to be a larger, it's going to be outside of the realm of any cobot. And so how do the empty ones come in and how do the full ones get on? Definitely very important considerations. And a discussion about operators and access to the cell, which I brought up earlier. At the bare minimum, even if I have just a simple cell, there's somebody bringing that empty pallet in and taking the pallets out. So that has to be a consideration. Safety perspective, because the guy's going to forklift something in, or even if it's a hand cart, they got to get it in, and they got to get it within the locator sensors, so that the locator sensors knows that the pallet is there, so it tells the robot, okay, there's an empty pallet, I can start building again. So if they don't locate, or whatever, let's say they didn't bring a pallet, or let's say they brought a pallet that was so beat up that the sensors couldn't read it, then that's going to be a problem. So How do empty pallets get in? How do full pallets get out? That is a huge consideration when you're looking at palletizing. So any questions on palletizing? I think that was about... Oh, there's one. Anything so far? Any questions? So this particular solution, I was trying to get one here at the show. It is a lift mechanism that works with all these different major robot brands, what we do Tucson. And what basically it does is it allows you to, mount the robot on this pedestal. It's still able to reach down to the pallet level to drop boxes, but reach over to the conveyor, but it's got the lift system so you can build a taller pallet stack. But what's nice about this is that using the on-robot gripper, the Tucson robot, and the lift with their pallet locators, you don't have to do any programming. All you end up doing is filling in a bunch of blanks in a web interface, and then compile the code, and then you download that into the robot. So it makes it really nice to do a do-it-yourself palletizing solution without having to know how to do a bunch of robot programming. So here's what it looks like. There's pallet locators. So This is just an adjustable stop, and that is actually the sensor that gets wired into here. And this is just a tube pallet out. These are showing European pallets, but I checked them for North American pallets, and these are adjustable, so they still are able to use them as stops. And then you have your software, which basically has you open up your Windows browser, and that's how you configure everything. So you got the software, you got the lift, you got one pallet station or two, you pick a robot, and then you pick a tool. And basically that's your hardware solution to be up and running with the palletizing. The way the application works is you first set up your box, and you go into their web interface to see my box is this by this by this, and it weighs this much. You say, okay, what gripper am I using? Do I have a slip sheet or not? Do I have a sensor at the end of my conveyor to say that the part there, yes or no? Do I have two pallet sensors or one pallet sensor? You're basically using the web interface to just configure all of this. Then on your pallet setup, you take the robot, you teach three corners of the pallet. Now the robot knows where the pallets are. And then you go to your pattern setup and you say, okay, I'm going to put three boxes this way, two, five boxes this way, whatever it might be. Do I want labels out? All that stuff. You basically set up a pattern, and then if I take that pattern and I do rotate it 90, you just click a button, rotate it 90. You say, okay, I've got five layers, whatever it might be. All of that is set in your pattern setup. Then you go to path optimization. It goes and calculates everything that it needs to do to optimize that path so that when I pick a box up off the conveyor, you know, I don't go up here and then place. If I'm doing like layer one, get high enough that I know it's off my conveyor and I just come over and I do it that way. So I'm just doing less motion. And then the lift will automatically raise to get to all the next layers. You don't have to program any of that in. You hit the pass setup, it calculates all the code, generates all the code, you take that file and you load it into the robot. They made it really straightforward to do these simpler pallet projects. Like I was saying, you could have one of these set up for every single box that you have, which would be perfectly fine. You could do that. It's just that the operator would have to go to the robot and select which one they're running. So if you wanted that fancy HMI and you wanted to do 30 different boxes with different pallet patterns, that's what I'm saying. Industrial robots have a leg up on that, but if you're doing something relatively straightforward, this would be a third price. The other model that we have, and this is a more mechanical solution, it still has a lift mechanism inside of it, but this is basically the robot controller sits inside. It also has two pallet sensors, and you've got some connectors and cabling and things like that. But in this solution here, you would have to write all the code. Where's my pallet? What's my box size? What routine am I running? Am I running 60 boxes? All that code you'd have to write. Where that lift station, it generates all of that code for you. This one here, you would end up writing it yourself. So, to each his own, some would rather do it this way because they're in complete control. Others would want to use the lift because it's a lot easier. So, machine tending. So, any questions on palletizing? Anybody have any palletizing apps? So basically what would happen is in the setup process, at least for that on robot, that lift 100, in the setup process, you just click a button that says, yes, I have slip sheets. And it's going to ask you, where is your slip sheet location? So you're going to have to teach it a location to go and pick the slip sheet, right? And then what it's going to do is a standard pallet is 40 by 48. So when you have your pallet locators in and you've taught your location where your pallet is, it will know that, okay, it's 40 by 48. My 48 is along this line. You just set your slip sheets to be the same. So that when I pick it up and I rotate it over here, it's in the same 40 by 48 is what I'm laying on my pallet. So all it is just an extra step, and it'll do it between every layer. So, does it every layer, but you might be able to skip layers. I can't remember. It's been a little while since I saw the software. You might be able to skip layers. Sure. Yeah. If you hit the pause button, as soon as you hit play, it's going to resume from where it left off, so yes. It's not like a normal, like, you wire up a push button station. It's a little different than that. Because that routine is kind of already developed canned routine, you really can't jump in the middle of the code and start writing extra stuff. But if you wanted to just have the teach pendant out there and hit pause and look at the subject there yourself, then hit resume, you can do that. So, machine tending. You know, CNC machines, very, very common, vertical cutoff saws, laser marking, you know, assembly machines. So when we look at machine tending, you know, the machine process has its own thing. The operator is literally there just to keep the machine fed. As long as I keep adding blanks into the CNC, I keep machining parts, I keep making money. That's really the key to robotics and machine tending. You know, the process in and of itself, we really don't get involved in any of that. All we're doing is literally what the operator does. Pick up this chunk of aluminum, stick it into the chuck, close the door, hit go, right? And that's pretty much the extent of it. If you start getting like way out of the realm of that, you start interfacing in the machine and doing what, that's a whole other animal. Most people usually don't want to go down that rabbit hole. Most of the time, you want to keep things fairly simple when you're doing machine tending. So you want to just have simple control back and forth to integrate. Obviously, you want to know if the door's open before you go running parts through. But machine tending is a very, on the surface again, it sounds very simple. I have a stack of parts. I need to put them into the machine. When the machine's done with them, I take them out and I move them over here. There are two of the biggest challenges with machine tending is your in-feed and your out-feed. So how do the parts come in? And in this case here, there's a couple different solutions. This one here, an operator loads a tray, and you'll see that the robot pulls that tray out on that side and starts feeding the machine. Same thing with this one here. The operator can load the trays, and you'll see like the buttons, you see those pilot lights and stuff up on that other one. So if this tray is out, then the robot knows that, so it's not looking for a tray. Once I push that tray in, there's interlocks that lock it so you can't open it anymore, so that the robot can now work on it on this side. So as long as the operator keeps this side full, the robot can open up the drawer and start feeding the CNC, and when it's done, it puts it right back into the same spot that it grabbed it from, and then closes the door. Once it closes the door, now the light on this side says, okay, operator, you have a finished part, take all the parts off, right? So these solutions that you see right here, that one there is just basically a bunch of pockets to put your parts in so they're located. The one up on the top, and these two are not actually cobots, but it doesn't mean you couldn't put a cobot on there. That one up on the top, that's one where you have like two very, very slow-moving conveyors where operator will load up blanks and the conveyor takes it to the machine. There's a camera that finds whatever your part's in and puts it inside the process. When it's done machining, puts it on the outbound conveyor that then moves it back over to this side so that the operator can take them away. And obviously there are sensors there to keep them from dropping on the floor. But these are very common in the machine tending world, and really the variety is what is your part, right? So machine tending, at least for CNCs and things like that, you typically have blanks. I got round bar stock or it's cut to, you know, whatever height, or I've got square, could be aluminum, could be steel, whatever it might be. But those blanks have to be staged for the CNC to be able to be fed. So where do you stage them is the important part. These over here, they are known locations so that the robot just says, here's part one, here's part two, part three, part four, if I got 10 by 10 grid. I just cycle through the whole 10 by 10 grid. I know where they are. It's easy for me to go over and grab them, put them in the CNC. Obviously, the chuck's in the same spot all the time. But I know where all my positions are. If I have a conveyor or something random, I have to have a camera system because I don't know where the parts are. So anyway, so my take on machine tending is if you can provide a mechanical solution to feed the machine, do so. It'll try to eliminate vision. I mean, I have vision solutions. I'd be more than happy to work with you on those. But if there's a mechanical way of doing it to eliminate vision, I go that route first. So these, and there's a variety of different setups, and it really comes down to product size and how much volume, right? So if I've got a, I think I can discuss that right here. So it all starts with the part. So it all starts with the part, obviously. It may sound simple, but a lot of people start with the robot first. Literally, it starts with the part. Part presentation is key. Is it a tray? Is the tray located, right? I've seen people that you can basically grab a tray of blanks and just put them onto the table. I put it down this way, put it down this way, whatever. Where did I put it? I would still need a camera now to locate the tray. But once I found the tray, now I know where all my parts are. Or if you have an in-feed solution that, like those trays there, that everything is located, then I don't need any vision. 2D vision, if it's on a conveyor, like those other ones, the 2D vision is a good, cost-effective solution. And it's very, very easy to set up and very easy to use because the product you're looking for is not really that difficult. The 3D solution, though, if I've got product that has different stack heights, or let's say I've rolled over a tray of a whole bunch of aluminum blanks and there's 200 of them, then I'm just grabbing individual parts. Well, because every time you grab layers, your height gets lower and lower, that's where you need a 3D camera to make sure that you're grabbing everyone before you go down a layer, right? Picking out of a bin. So I got a large box and I got a whole bunch of parts in there I need to grab and pick those out. The 3D solution is pretty much the only way you're going to do that. There's people who use 2D and put like a laser on it to get your height. You can spend more time screwing with it than if you just bought a 3D camera. And cycle time. You know, the capacity of your feed solution is going to be determined by your cycle time and how often you want somebody to come back and feed that machine. So, for example here, 15 seconds into the machining, and let's say we give 10 seconds to the robots, we got 25 seconds per part. And if I had 200 parts in my feed solution, well then I got to come back every 83 minutes to load it back up. If that's good, great, run with it. But if you're saying, well, geez, no, I need 400 parts, well then you got to start thinking about how can I feed 400 parts in the floor space that I have. So there's no one size fits all. It really comes down to, you know, how big is your part, what's your cycle time, and how often do you want to come back and to replenish it. I mean, I've worked on solutions where, you know, the operator's job, it's so fast that the operator's job, they dump these into the hopper, they dump these in the hopper, and by the time they're done with these in the hopper, they got to come back and dump these in the hopper. So depending upon what you're looking at, you know, it's really going to determine how fast or how often the operator has to come by. And in many cases, let's say you do have that, you know, operator comes by once an hour, those paybacks are really good because now I might be able to have four CNCs out there and I can have one operator servicing multiple because I can keep them fed all day long. And when we talk about interfacing to the CNC, one of the biggest considerations I always mention to people is try to do it with I/O if you can instead of the networking, even if it's available. Most of the CNC manufacturers, the older ones will possibly bring out like an I/O terminal for things like automatic chuck, you know, open and close the chuck, open and close the door, start and stop the machine, you know, instead of push buttons. If it's really old, they might just still have just the push buttons, in which case you've got to figure out the wiring from a push button and bring that to your own little terminal strip and kind of, whether I push the button or turn on this input, it's the same thing. Newer machines typically have Ethernet I/O, and if they do, that's great. Sometimes they'll map all the functions right to an Ethernet table and provide you with what that data is and where the locations are. That's great. Other times what they'll do because they'll have their own little I.O. block. It still might be Ethernet to the I.O. block, but they'll tell you, if you want to open up the chuck, wire this point. Close the chuck, wire this point. So it really depends upon the CNC manufacturer. But if you can get away with doing it with just 24-volt I.O., I highly recommend it, because as I stated right in the beginning, that the process in and of itself, we don't really do anything with the process. We're just the robot feeding the process, so the less wiring and interaction you have to do, the better off you're going to be. Make life a lot easier. And you may have seen videos where the robot, if I have like a little two-finger gripper and I can pick up my part and I can put it into the chuck, well, you'll probably see videos where the robot can actually go and grab the door and close the door, and then close your fingers on your gripper and push the start button. It looks great on YouTube, but most of the time, just wire it. I mean, you can certainly do it if you want, but aside from a couple of videos that I've seen that were developed in Europe, maybe that's why they wanted to do it, I don't know. I would just suggest hardware and stuff. So when you start looking at larger parts in that 3D world, picking like billets and things like that, what's good about this is that it's very demanding work to have somebody reaching into these bins and picking up, you know, chunks of steel, right? Who wants to do that all day? That upper left-hand corner, you see the camera is actually mounted onto the gripper itself. So what you'll do is you'll take it over and you hold the camera over here and you'll take a picture of your bin, and then you'll go down, you'll grab your part, and then in almost, you know, probably 90% of the applications here, you'll probably take it over to like a little, like a V block that's on an angle, take your part, drop it over, and it'll settle itself, and then you re-grip it before you take it into your next machine. Because 3D picking is good, but it might not be that plus or minus a tenth of a millimeter that you might want. So you go into the bin, you pick it up, and you take it out. The reason that we have that extension is because you don't want the camera or the robot wrist unit to go inside the bin. You want the extension and whatever gripper you have to go inside the bin. You don't want everything else going inside. And then we build in like routines that look at if I've got like a 20-inch long extension and my part is sitting at a 45-degree angle, I can't pick here because I would hit the bin. That's built into the software to allow for collision detection. So that's pretty normal there. And that one in the middle, that's a typical application where the operator has a whole bunch of blanks, but they're not set up perfectly into a tray. They just want to wheel them into the solution and walk away and go do something else. And that's great, but that right there, it looks simple to pick. As far as the robot knows, it needs a 3D system to go and find those. There would be no other way, no easy way to go and find those. Then the bottom picture here, that shows, these are nice, simple solutions. If again, let's say the cycle time on that is a little higher, and it doesn't take too long for the operator to put this in here. The reason it's up on an angle like that is everything's located, so I know exactly where to pick things. And in that case there, I could, depending upon the machining, I can put them back into their spots, or I can put it on the tray over here. So machine tending is really, the motion side of it isn't that difficult. It's the product infeed that really is going to determine how difficult your application is. So when we start looking at the part itself, vacuum, even on the metal parts, vacuum is still a great solution. Vacuum comes in from the top. That is about as easy as it gets. If I've got a flat surface and I can get at it from the top, vacuum makes life so much easier. And people sometimes say, well, geez, it's vacuum. How much can I pick up with vacuum? If you wanted to pick up a 4x8 sheet, a half inch thick steel, I could pick that up with vacuum. Right? So you can pick up a lot with vacuum. It takes a lot of cups, takes a lot of airflow. But a solid surface like that, not very porous, you'll pull vacuum in a heartbeat, and then it's just the amount of physical size of the cups that you have. But if you can come at something from the top, and you've got got a nice surface, and we've got cups that work well with oil, you know, slightly oily metal, things like that, high abrasion resistance, things like that. So if you can come at it from the top, you just make life so much easier. The challenge that you'll see, though, is you see some of these grippers here, right? So picture that you got to pick up, like, rectangular chunks of steel, right? Or even circular. So, I got a 6-inch puck, and let's say it's 2 inches deep, right? And that, let's call that 40 pounds, whatever it might be. I need either a really big cup or multiple cups to be able to effectively grab that without dropping it. But then you say, oh, but my smallest part is only 2 inches. Okay, I got a problem now, because obviously that big 4-inch cup isn't going to pick up the 2-inch. And if I had, let's say, four individual cups and I turn on all four to pick up this piece, do I have enough zones? Can I just use one cup to pick up the little guy? So you have to be aware when you're looking at your smallest product to your largest product that the gripper doesn't get in the way of picking up those smaller products, right? Because if I had a gripper large enough to pick up biggest product, and then over here I'm picking up my smallest one, but the gripper is this big, that could present a problem, right? We can zone the gripper, we can control things like that, but it's a consideration that you have to look at. I had one customer was picking up bags, and there were smaller bags of like cat food or something like that, but they were like 5 pounds, but he wanted to pick up a sack of five. Well, he was adding length this way, but no more surface area up here to pick from. So, yeah, I got to a point where he said, well, can I pick up 10? I'm like, well, no, it's physically impossible because you've only got so much surface area to apply your vacuum cups. If you're adding weight in this direction but no surface area, then that becomes very difficult to basically impossible. Two jaw grippers, I mean, we've all seen them, just basic little open closed grippers. These here are actually servo grippers, and servos, you know, you pay more money for the servo grippers, but they give you so much more information. It's very, very helpful to use those, because now, if I'm closing on a product, I control the force, but I also control the distance. So when I'm closing on something, if I'm trying to grab a 10-millimeter part, and it goes into 3 millimeters, I know that I don't have a part. If I grab something that was at 12 millimeters, what the heck did I grab? I didn't grab my 10-millimeter part. So servo grippers are very helpful for that. That one right there with the cable coming out, the servo is actually built inside. So all you do is you bring in that, you know, little turn connector, you wire it in there. Your on, off, your position, your force, and all your sensing is done all right inside. Three jaw grippers, same way. That's a magnet gripper. And what's nice about that one, it's just a little air cylinder inside. When the air cylinder is down, the magnet basically is close enough to your material that it operates. You put it up here, you operate the air cylinder, the magnet pulls so far away that the product drops. It's very, very quick in its acquire and drop-off time. With a servo gripper, there's time to energize the coil and time to de-energize the coil, so your pickup and drop-off times are a little longer. If you want high speed, then the magnet gripper there is probably the better way to go. Standard pneumatic grippers, they're all over the place. And then servo grippers. Again, unlike that one, this one's a little different. We've got two jaw, three jaw. You can see we can put two grippers on one end effector. And that's very commonly used in the CNC world, where I pick up a blank and I go and put it into the CNC and then I go pick up a blank. And then the other side says, okay, now when that one's done, I go in, I pick up the one that's done, and then I'm already here, I put the blank in, and now I got my finished one, I go over here and set it down. So it just basically, you know, increases your productivity, being able to have two grippers on one end. And being all servo-driven, again, we have control of speed and force position. You know, did I pick up the product? Is it the right force? Did I drop it? You know, all that stuff is really easy to implement when you got the servo. So if you want to learn a little bit more about machine tanning, and specifically those grippers I just showed you, this is a good website. So on Robot, on Unfortunately, they could not be here today. They had something going on in Dallas, so all their people were pulled down there. But they have the pre-engineered grippers that we would use for machine tending. And if you go to the OnRobot website, there's a link called Learn, upper corner. And when you click on Learn, there's a whole bunch of different applications you'll see listed here. And each one will actually run you through a couple different videos. What to expect, how do I get started, how do I, you know, using vision. You know, it'll talk about things like the product in feed, it'll talk about some things in consideration, interfacing with the CNC. So if you've got some time and you want to check out how we do machine tending, this is a very good resource to look at. Alright, I'm going to finish up here quickly. So welding. Hopefully you guys got a chance to see our welder that was out there. So what we're doing, I mentioned earlier that we're doing some function packages and we're going to be putting these on our website. Basically what it is that in order to do some of these things like machine tending, palletizing, welding, you'll need certain components. A machine frame, obviously a robot. You need some tooling. Do you need a welder? Do you need that lift station? What gripper are you using? So we're going to have a solution set up on our website where you can actually go through and ask, you know, we ask you questions about the application. And it'll come up at the end and say, here's what you're looking at. Now, in the case of welding, you know, people are kind of like, is cobot welding real? Or is it just like one of those ones where people are just tossing a cobot on it because they think it's cool? So why would you do it? Does it work? And is it easy to use? Well, the things it cannot do, that's always important. So why? If you have shorter production runs, if I got something I'm building 10,000 a year and I've got this big fixture set up, more than likely you're probably going to build a dedicated pallet site or a dedicated welding site. But in many cases, I might have some shorter run and I want to just basically put some parts in a fixture and hit go and walk away and have the robot do all the welding. That's very good. It's a good solution for a cobot welder. Obviously, the weld torches aren't that heavy, so it's easy for a robot to carry those. Operator loads up the fixture, so now I'm not entering and exiting a big robot cell. You know, if I don't have this big position or rotating parts around, like a big, huge automotive plant, those, obviously, you have to have the door closed and completely fenced. But in many cases, operator has a bunch of parts that are already pre-cut fashion parts. They load them into the fixture and clamp things down. And then all they have to do is hit go and the welder welds it back up. By the time they're going to grab more parts or maybe they go to another process, when they come back, that part's finished. So from that standpoint of an operator still loads the station, your payback isn't the fact that you eliminated a welder. Your payback is the fact that now that person can get more done because once they load the fixture and make everything that's in the fixture properly, they can go on and do something else while the robot just draws the lines and circles. And it's a smaller footprint. Again, you know, you saw that weld table out there. Had they let us, we could have actually welded out there. It's literally, it's not inherently dangerous. You still have to put, like, weld curtains on the side. If you're going to be staying in and watching it, you still have to have a welding hood. But it's a smaller footprint. You don't have to build a dedicated cell for it. Does it work? Absolutely. There's a couple ways of approaching welding. You can use the robot as just a manipulator, and you set up your weld schedule in your power supply. If you're familiar with Miller, you set it up, here's my wire speed, here's my voltage, here's whatever. And you can just pick that and say, okay, I'm going to use weld schedule 15. Then you tell the robot to go, and it just does the motion. But now, when do you start and stop the arc? When do you control the gas flow? Like that. And you can still do all that. A better way of doing it is where the actual welder itself, like what we got out here, and the robot, is actually in control of the welder. So you set up your weld schedules in the robot, you could have a whole boatload of them, depending upon what you're welding. You set up the weld schedule, you set up your weave pattern, you set up your torch, and you set up your welder, and then now what you'll do is the robot ends up being controlling the welder. Wire feed speed, the voltage, it will get current feedback, it can do heat calculations, obviously it can do the path, it controls when you have an approach, then here's my start weld, I turn on my arc, when do I turn on my gas, right? Then I do my weld, when do I turn off my gas, when do I turn off my arc? that is controlled inside the robot controller, and it's easily just, you know, point and click filling in the blanks. No robot programming is really needed. You have to understand, obviously, a linear or a circular move or a blended move, but other than that, you enter the data that you want through your weld, and then it just draws the path. So it makes it really easy to do, and a big advantage is going to be, I'm building 50 of these today, but tomorrow I'm doing something else, or somebody else wants me to try this and see if it works. It's very easy. Obviously, you got to fixture up your parts, but it's very easy to get back in and teach new weld builders. So we have the lines and the arcs and also the tooltip direction. So if I go to teach a circle, I can teach a circle here. And then if I teach another point over here and I say draw 360, it will maintain that tooltip or orientation as it goes around the circle. You don't have to teach a whole bunch of points. You just basically teach a couple points and it will draw that circle. So the tooltip orientation is controlled for you. You know, we could do a zigzag weave, we can do a trapezoidal, we can do circles and ellipses, so we have a couple different weave patterns. And being that it's a robot, it's very repeatable. So once you've got things fixed up and you teach your path, and you run some samples, get it to where you like it, save that, and just run it, run it, run it. So there's two ways we can use the robot analog output to a robot controller. That one that's out on the floor right now, it's a Envision 250 or 350 from Miller. It is set up to use analog. So analog wiring for wire feed and voltage, and then analog back in for current. So that's how, and then we have digital outputs for controlling arc start and gas. The other way of doing it is we get a little PLC in there, and it acts as an interface between Ethernet IP option on the welder. We have Ethernet IP on the robot already, so we need the PLC to be an Ethernet master to both devices. What you get there now is, because it's Ethernet IP, there's more data. All the start, stops, and controls are still there, but now there's a lot more data to work with as well. So this is what we're offering up. As you saw the weld table, it's out there. So you need the machine frame, obviously you need the robot, the torch, the cabling, the wire feed. In this case here, clamp table, we have 16mm clamps. You don't need that table if you have your own solution. That's perfectly fine as well. What we're going to be doing is working with Fronius, Miller, and Lincoln, and even Close, Close Welding as well. It's a European company that Doosan also worked with. Let's see if we can get this even working here. Come on. It's hard to operate the mouse because it's on an incline. Every time I move it, it slides down. Now, this is a system completely built up by Clues, but if you didn't want their table and their system and everything else, but this basically shows you it's really not that difficult to set up a welding solution, and it would be really repeatable and, again, no real dedicated weld cell that's going to cost you tons of money. And working with, like I said, over here in North America, Miller, Lincoln, and Fronius are the three that I see the most. These guys are in North America. They do have an office over in Chicago. What you're seeing here is, I don't know if you saw it up there, there's a button we push on your robot to allow, puts it in a free drive mode. You move it around, you teach your points, you can manually jog it. Any of your positions that you want, you can also add it very easily. You know, because when you're hand guiding something, it might say 223.55mm, like, okay, 22 is good. So you don't necessarily have to do it. You know, like I said, hand guiding, it's only going to get you close. Then we have the simulation where you can run it, you can look at it. And in that particular case, what he was doing there is on the Doosan, we can actually because it's torque monitoring, we can actually use that and push the robot to be like a start button. You know, I don't think I can hold that by hand and make it look any good. Basically, the last thing I want to look at is from a welding, what does it do and what does it can't do? All right. Smaller weld stations, smaller parts, operator sets up a fixture. Those are great solutions for that. You can also set up turntables. Let's say you wanted to have a load station while the welder is doing over your welding. The challenge with that is you got to still make sure you have some plastic in front of you so that the operator, because I'm guessing the operator is not going to want to show down when they're loading the fixture. We can look at solutions like that, and we can use our safety fencing as well. So what it can't do, the seam tracking. So if you have your fixture that is slightly off, we can't adjust for that. We would not know that. All we're going to do is take the path that you taught it. So when we look at like our ABB robots, we have through the arc seam tracking. So if the seam is off a little bit, we can actually still follow that. If we see that the gap is getting wider, we will know that. We also have the ability to add a third-party vision system where the camera is looking at the seam as the weld is being driven. No cobot on the planet can do that yet, but we can do that with ABB. When you start looking at really large parts, like large positioners and things like that, you can probably do all that with a cobot, just move the cobot into position. But typically when you start getting those really large parts that you got to weld, like car frames and things like that, you're probably not talking cobot anymore. You're probably talking a regular industrial robot. And then interpolated motion with the robot and the weld positioner. So even if I had a seventh axis down here, I could go to this spot and do some welding. Then I can go to this spot and do some welding. But I'm not able to have that linear track at the same time I'm doing the welding. At least not under perfect control, not interpolated. Because what you'd have to figure out is, okay, here's my linear speed of my welder. Here's my linear speed of my track. Do I hold the welder stationary and do everything from the track? Or do I do a combination of the two? So it's a lot more challenging. With robots like the ABB, they have an integrated seventh axis that's interpolated with the TCP head. So you have all of that control. Cobots don't have that. But if you wanted to add it to a positioner that could move it into a different position, then yeah, you can certainly do that with it. And no spot welding, mainly because spot welding guns are just too big. Alright, so cobots are very versatile. Machine tending, palletizing, and welding are, everybody's asking about those right now. That's pretty much what everybody wants. The function packages, I'm still in development on those, but what you see out there is the welding one. Less engineering time to get up and running, faster payback. And then the pre-engineered solutions, although you pay a little bit more for the pre-engineered solutions, it's already done. You basically bolt it up and you're not spending a lot of time engineering things. You jump in and start your application. So using the end-of-arm tools that are pre-engineered, like the mod robot or smalls, vision systems are basically plug-and-play right now. All the control to have a robot control the vision is already written. Years ago, you'd have to write a whole bunch of control to control the camera. All of that has gone away. I mean, our camera system, you can set it up right from the teach pad to the robot. So they really, over the last 5 years, tried to make things a lot more. You work on the application, you don't work on the engineering. And do it yourself is obviously very common, or we can have it integrated. If you have a solution that you say, you know what, it's a little outside my wheelhouse, we have integrated partners that we work with in all of our power mission regions that we can give you a full turnkey or any level in between. So we know that sometimes getting into robotics can be a bit of a challenge. So we can always bring other resources in to make sure that your first go around is as successful as it can be. The last thing we want to do is get somebody set up with a robot and then find out that they're struggling with it and then they shove it off into the corner. That's the last thing we want. We want to make sure that it works for you. questions at all?